Hello dear students, welcome to online English classes. This is Prem Ashwin, lecturer in English, Gopalaswamy Shishuvihara Independent PU College, Mysore. Well, you know that we have started with a bridge course. In this series of videos, I'll teach you one of the important grammar topics, that is subject-verb agreement. Rapid changes are taking place in the study of English language at all levels of education with regard to both content and outlook. Times have changed. A lot of research has been done in the area of language study because the rigidity of grammar is considered to be the student's nightmare. A knowledge of grammar is to be acquired indirectly through usage, not by memorizing the several rules with its innumerable exceptions. But it's very hard for the non-native speakers of English language to acquire mastery over the language. So, the working knowledge of English is very important today, as English has emerged as a global language and it has become the most facile and most commonly used medium of international communication. Well, you have been introduced to these two books titled Reflections and Articulation. Well, the course book titled Reflections stressed the importance of literature, some classics and poems, for they represent the quintessence of the culture of people who speak the language. But equal importance is given to the study of grammar as well. Well, this book titled Articulation deals with grammar and it carries 50 marks. And this book is specially tailored, especially designed to suit the needs of present days. And it encourages students to use English in their daily lives. I hope you will definitely like it. Well, before we get into the topic, let us understand what grammar is. Grammar is a person's knowledge and use of a language. That means the rules in a language for changing the forms of words and joining them into sentences. Everyone whose desire is to be understood by others should acquire the art of speaking and writing the language correctly. Good English can be easily acquired if you learn how to construct and use simple sentences. Well, in this session, I'll teach you all about subject-verb agreement. Why subject-verb agreement is important? In speaking and writing a language, grammar and sentence construction are of paramount importance. While this is also true for informal piece of writing and speech, grammar mistakes while speaking and writing the language reduce the credibility of people. Therefore, it is important to ensure that subjects and verbs always agree with each other. The relationship between subject and verb lies at the heart of grammatically correct English. Subject-verb agreement unifies a sentence and makes it easier to understand. It's not as easy as it sounds, but not as hard as it looks either. However, it is essential for you to master. If you learn all the rules and practice it every day, speaking and writing English with correct subject-verb agreement is no problem at all. Well, we will start with the basics. And in the following session, we will discuss some important rules associated with subject-verb agreement. Let us see how to make a sentence with correct verb form for different subjects and how to use pronouns in the place of nouns and how to use the verb be, that is am, is, are, was and were, and how to use the primary auxiliary verb has and have. So before we begin to talk about subject-verb agreement, let us understand what subject is, how to identify subject and verb in a sentence, and then we will understand what exactly is subject-verb agreement. If you are ready, let's get started. In most of the sentences, there are two parts. The subject and the predicate. The subject part represents what is talked about or written about. It could be a person, place, thing or an idea that is doing or being something. So the rest of the sentence is called as predicate. In a sentence, there can be a noun, pronoun or a group of words that are used like a noun. This stands for the thing talked about or written about, and this is known as subject substantive. Here the word substantive means real or solid. Let us look into examples. Let us take a sentence. In this sentence, people live happily. In this sentence, the word people is the subject substantive. So, the rest of the sentence, that is live happily, becomes the predicate. So, it talks about the word people. So, how do we identify verb in it? Remember, the predicate of a sentence should always have verb in it. Here in the sentence, the word live is the verb. It talks about the subject people. So, remember, the predicate of a sentence should always have verb in it, and the verb talks about the subject people. And the word happily becomes an adverb and add to the meaning of the verb leave. It add to the meaning of the verb leave. Let us take one more example to identify subject and verb in a sentence. In this sentence, people who live in glass houses should not throw stones. So here in this sentence, the word people is the subject substantive. As I already told you, the word substantive means real or solid. So here in this sentence, people is the important word, but we may like to know more about people. So the group of words who live in glass houses tells us about the people. So this group of words is called as modifier. Here the modifier describes the word people or restricts its meaning, and it is also called as adjectival phrase. An adjectival phrase can also have verb in it. So here in this sentence, the word live is the verb. So, the rest of the sentence, that is, should not throw stones, becomes the predicate. So, as I already mentioned, the predicate of a sentence should always have a verb in it. So, here in the predicate, the word throw is the verb. It shows the action performed by the subject, people. In some sentences, in addition to the verb, some more words may have to be used to make it clear. Take for example, in the sentence, water boils. Here in the sentence, the verb boils tells us all about the subject, water. But in some cases, the verb by itself may not tell us everything. We may have to add a few more words, as in the case of subject substantive. We may have to add a few more words to make things clear. Take for example, in the sentence, the horse runs faster than the dog is the sentence. Here in the sentence, the horse is the subject. So the remaining part of the sentence, that is runs faster than the dog, is the predicate. As I already mentioned, the predicate of a sentence should always have a verb in it. So here in the predicate, the word runs is the verb, and the words faster than the dog add to the meaning of the verb runs. Let us take one more example. Here in the sentence, people watch movies. Here in the sentence, the word people is the subject, and the remaining part of the sentence, that is watch movies, is the predicate. As I already told you, the predicate of a sentence should always have a verb in it. So here in the predicate, the word watch is the verb. But as I already told you, in a sentence, there can be a noun, pronoun, or a group of words that are used like a noun. This stands for the thing talked about or written about, and it is also called as subject substantive. So here in the sentence, instead of using noun people, we can use the pronoun they. So instead of saying people watch movies, we can use the pronoun and we can say they watch movies. So in that case, the pronoun they become the subject of a sentence. So we can conclude that a noun or a pronoun can become the subject of a sentence. Now, based on point of view, subject may be in first person, second person, or third person. In first person, we have I and we. In second person, we have you. And in third person, we have he, she, it, and they. In third person, we have he, she, it, and they. And based on subject count, subject may be singular or plural. Based on subject count, subject may be singular or plural. So what is subject verb agreement then? Well, you know that every English sentence has a subject and a verb. For making a sentence grammatically correct, a verb must agree with its subject, not subject with its verb. So a verb must agree with its subject. A verb must agree with its subject in number and person. For making a sentence grammatically correct, a verb must agree with its subject in number and person. That is to say, in any sentence, a singular subject takes a singular form of the verb, a plural subject takes a plural form of the verb. plural form of the, so that is to say, in any sentence, a singular subject takes singular form of the verb, a plural subject takes plural form of the verb. Now, why don't you pause the video and write down this on your notebook? Because as I explain the examples, you should keep this rule in your mind. Let us look into examples to make things clear. Let us look into examples where subject changes from singular to plural and how the verb forms change according to it. Well, this side you can see singular subject and singular verb, and this side you can see plural subject and plural verb. In the first sentence, we have a singular noun as the subject, girl. Well, in this sentence, the subject is a singular noun, one girl. So the verb needs to be singular in form. So we add s to the verb and make it singular. So the verb used here is singular sings. But in the second sentence, we have a plural subject, girls, and a plural verb, sing. Notice that the plural form of the verb sing is its base form itself. We don't add s or es to the end. Well, in the second sentence, we see a plural subject and a plural verb. So the plural verb used here is sing, not sings. Notice that the nouns and verbs are behaving in opposite ways. The singular noun girl becomes girls with an s in the plural form, but the verb has an s in the singular form, but the plural verb sing does not have an s. Let us look into some more examples to make things clear. So here the singular subjects are girl, boy, car, bangle, lady, and grandfather. So the singular verbs all have s and es at the end. Sings, plays, goes, looks, speaks, and has. But when we look at the plurals, this is reversed. All the plural subjects have s at the end. Girls, boys, cars, bangles, ladies, and grandparents. And the plural verb does not have an s or es at the end. Sing, play, go, look, speak, and have. Now with plural nouns, there are some irregular nouns. Take for example, in the sentence, that boy plays football. Instead of saying that boy, I can say that child. Now the plural verb becomes those children, not childs. But still, children is the plural subject. We use the plural form play without s or es at the end. Similarly, there are several irregular nouns. For example, man is singular, men is plural. Woman is singular, women is plural. Person is singular, people is plural. Now, there is one more example here, but this is going to be a little tricky one. In the sentence, John lives in London. Here, John is the name of one person. So, it's a singular subject. So, the verb needs to be singular in form. So, we used lives. But what if John has a wife called Rosie? Would you say John and Rosie lives in London? Well, John is one person, so singular subject. Similarly, Rosie is another person, again singular subject. However, John and Rosie are two people, so the subject is plural here. So we should use the plural form of the verb and we say John and Rosie live in London, not lives in London, because John and Rosie is considered as plural subject. Remember, the plural subject takes a plural form of the verb without s or es at the end. Since John and Rosie is considered plural subject, we use the verb form leave. This type of subject connected by and is called a compound subject. Well, there is another type of compound subject connected by or. For example, John or Rosie lives in London. So notice that we have a singular verb leaves. It is because of the conjunction or. That means either John or Rosie is in London, not both of them. So the subject here is singular. Remember, a singular subject takes a singular form of the verb with S or ES at the end. So we say John or Rosie lives in London. This type of compound subject connected by or is not common, but still useful to keep this rule in mind. All right. There are a lot of nouns in these sentences. Let us change all the nouns into pronouns. Let us see a few singular and plural pronouns. So here, instead of saying that girl, I can say she. Instead of saying that child or that boy, I can say he. Instead of saying that car, I can say it. Instead of saying bangle, again I can say it. Instead of saying that lady, I can say she. And instead of saying my grandfather, I can say he. Instead of saying John or Rosie, I can say he or she. Well, you can see all the singular noun subjects have been changed into singular pronouns. Well, we can also change all the plural subjects into pronouns as well. So we can say, instead of saying those girls, we can say they. And instead of saying those boys or those children, we can say, instead of saying your bangles, we can say they look nice. And instead of saying those ladies, again we can say they. My grandparents, we can change into they. John and Rosie, we can change the plural pronoun they. But in some cases, we can also use the pronoun we. Take for example, if you're talking to the English speaking ladies, they can say we speak English. Similarly, if you're in a conversation with John or Rosie, John might say we live in London. Children can say we play football. Here is the table which shows you this pattern. The first row has singular nouns: girl, boy, bike, bangle, lady, grandfather, and John. And it also has pronouns such as he, she, and it. And all the singular verbs have S or ES at the end. And in the second row, we have plural nouns such as girls, boys, bikes, bangles, ladies, grandparents, John and Rosie, along with two pronouns, that is we and they. And all the plural form of the verbs not have an S. Well, you might have noticed that there are two important pronouns are missing here. The pronoun I and you. Let me ask you a question. Are I and you singular or plural? Where would you put them? Well, the pronoun I is always singular. I am is always one person, so singular. And you, usually singular, because usually we focus on one person when we speak. But you can also be plural if you are talking to more than one person, like I am teaching all of you. So the pronoun I is singular and you is both singular and plural. But the rule in English that with both I and you, we use plural verb forms. There is no real reason for this. It's just the rule. Take for example, if I say I read books every day and you make very good coffee. Notice that I did not say I read or you makes. I said I read and you make. With both I and you, we use plural form of the verb. Well, this basic subject verb agreement rule also applies to the negative forms as well. Remember, this basic subject verb agreement rule, that is, a singular subject takes a singular form of the verb, a plural subject takes a plural form of the verb, only applies in present tense. In past tense, subject verb agreement is not a problem because you have only one past tense verb form in English. The past tense of sing is sang. So we can say that girl sang well. It is same for the both singular and plural subjects. We can say that girl sang well, those girls sang well. In other sentences, we would say looked, spoke, had and lived. So remember, this basic subject verb agreement rule applies only in present tense. This rule works for all verb forms. For example, sing, live, look, speak, jump, have, leave, talk, play, etc. Actually, this basic subject verb agreement rule applies to all verb forms except for one, and that is the verb be. Because the verb be has its own subject verb agreement rule. Let us see how the verb be works. Well, you know that verbs in English have two present tense form, that is sing, sings, jump, jumps, and one past tense form, that is sing, sang, jump, jumped. But the verb be has three present tense forms, that is am, is, are, and it also has two past tense forms, that is was and were. So here is a table that shows you how the verb be works. In the present tense, if the subject is I, use the verb am. When we write it in a sentence, we can say, I am a singer, I am going to do it. If the subject is singular or any one of these pronouns, that is he, she, it, we use the verb is. He is Mr. John, she is running, it is raining. If the subject is plural or any one of these pronouns, that is you, we, they, we use the verb are. So when we write it in a sentence, we say you are late, we are dancing. If there is a noun called children, we can say children are playing. And if there is a pronoun called they, we can say they are playing. But in the past tense, the rules are different. If the subject is singular or any one of these pronouns, that is I, he, she and it, we use the verb was. We can say it was raining, he was coming, she was shocked, I was tired and it was raining. If the subject is plural or any one of these pronouns, that is you, we, they, we use the verb were. We can say you were rude, we were traveling, they were dancing. Or if there is a noun called dogs, we can say the dogs were barking. If there is a pronoun in the place of noun dog, we can say they were barking. You see that some of these sentences have continuous verbs, that is am going, is raining, are dancing or is dancing, were traveling, was coming, were barking. These are in the present tense or past continuous tense. But the verb form be, that is am, is, are, was and were, what changes depending on the subject. If you memorize these simple rules in this table, you will find that using verb correctly is no problem at all. I'll stop my session here. In the next session, we will discuss some important rules associated with subject-verb agreement. Thank you.